Amen. Well, you look good this morning. I hope you're excited to be here. We are continuing our series from the book of Proverbs, talking about choosing wisely. And so if you have a Bible this morning, you want to turn with us to Proverbs, you can turn with us to Proverbs chapter 3. Proverbs chapter 3 is where we're going to be this morning. We're going to take a look and what the Bible has to say this morning about choosing wisely. Choosing wisely. Just kind of recap where we've been. If you haven't been here, or maybe you missed a week or two, we've been studying the book of Proverbs, which is known as the book of wisdom. And as we've been sharing over the last couple weeks, the writer of Proverbs was who?
Solomon,
correct. And over his lifetime, Solomon wrote some 3,000 different sayings or poems or songs, as it were. And we've been looking at what he's had to say in the book of Proverbs. And what I love about the book of Proverbs is that we've been talking about, and this is just a reminder because repetition is the key to mastery, is that there, in the book of Proverbs, the way that Solomon writes, he gives us two possible choices. And he sets up two types of people to us, an example. On this side, we have the fool. And on this side, we have the wise man. And the way that Solomon wrote is so relevant to our lives because he gives us these practical examples, doesn't he, of a wise person and a foolish person. And basically, what he says is, don't be the fool. Amen? How many of you know? He says, don't be that guy. And so what we've been learning over the last several weeks is why it's so important to study the book of Proverbs, why we need wisdom in our lives, and what we can glean from it. So in week number one, we talked about the fear of the Lord. And we looked at C.S. Lewis' writing from the Chronicles of Narnia. And one of the things that we love about what C.S. Lewis said is that he said this, they're talking about Aslan, who is a type of Christ, and he says this, he isn't safe, said Lucy. Safe, said Mr. Beaver. Don't you hear what Mrs. Beaver's telling you? Who said anything about safe? Of course he isn't safe, but he's good. And so what we learn is that fearing the Lord has to do with recognizing who he is, as I said earlier. Isaiah tells us that he is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. And so walking in wisdom, living a life of wisdom, starts with understanding that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Amen. Are you here today?
Amen.
Honey, you missed it. I said repetition is key and mastery. We're reviewing. In fact, Proverbs chapter 9, verse 10 says this, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. If you and I don't fear God, then there's a high probability we will not walk in wisdom. Which means that we will not choose wisely. On a very superficial level, a lot of what happens today among Christians is debate about what's right and wrong. Or better yet, what can I get away with and still go to heaven? Amen. Are you here this morning? You don't have to say amen if you agree with that too much. But as we've been talking about, that is a very elementary, immature almost way to view the kingdom and who God is. Paul talked about pursuing wisdom. In fact, he said, is everything lawful for me? Sure, but not everything is beneficial.
Yeah.
And what he was talking about there was wisdom. A better approach to the choices that we make in life is this. Is it wise or is it foolish? As we learned in Financial Peace with Dave Ramsey, he said, the Bible doesn't say sin, or debt is sinful, but it certainly says it's stupid.
Yeah.
And really, that's what we're talking about when we talk about the book of Proverbs. We're talking about choosing wisdom, and so we have to understand that God is all. He is the beginning and the end. He is holy, and that we need him. And we have to continually live in this posture in order to walk in wisdom. Last week we talked about not leaning on our own understanding. And in this message last week, what we talked about is how there are many times where we have this plan or this idea in mind of how we would like to see things play out. And it doesn't happen, and it leads us to a place of frustration. It leads us to a place where we doubt God. We say, God, I had this plan. I thought that this was going to be, and I shared a story about a pastor who went to a Christian school, and he had tried out for a choir, and he thought he was going to be a part of this traveling choir, and it didn't work out. He wasn't accepted, and so he was kind of dismayed. But several years later, he had the opportunity to actually lead a choir, where he then met his wife, and he could see how God's timing was everything. And so even at that time in college where he thought, oh, I'm going to be on this traveling choir, it's going to be so awesome, and it didn't happen, rather than get frustrated or rather than get confused and give up on God, he had a certain level of maturity to trust God's timing and say, well, okay, I'm going to trust God. And then later on down the road, something better came about. You see, the reality is that the Bible doesn't say that we are to ignore our intellect. But we're certainly supposed to couple it with our faith in who God is.
Amen.
So not leaning on our understanding doesn't mean we don't pursue knowledge. It doesn't mean that we don't pursue the wisdom that God gives us. What it means is we trust God's plan ultimately for our lives. We can pray, we can plan, but we leave the results up to God.
Yes.
Yeah.
Boy, that's one of the hardest things to learn as a pastor. It is, I can have a plan, and I can even invite you to pray with me. Amen?
Yeah.
But ultimately, I have to leave the results up to God.
Yes.
We talked about Roger Staubach, who had to learn to obey Coach Landry, even though many times he felt like maybe he knew better. I hope that this has been beneficial to you, because ultimately what I envision for this series is that we grow in wisdom. We learn to choose wisely. Boy, it's hard in our day and age, isn't it? And what we're going to learn this morning is that there are two different paths that we can choose in life. And one leads to eternal life and everlasting life, and one leads to destruction. We're going to look this morning in Proverbs. I want you to turn there with me to Proverbs chapter 14. We'll have it on the screen here for you if you prefer it that way. But I want us to look at Proverbs chapter 14. And this morning, we're going to talk about the wrong way. The wrong way. Look at Proverbs chapter 14, verse 11 through 12. Just a couple of verses here. If you're there, say amen.
Amen.
It says this: the house of the wicked will be destroyed, but the tent of the upright will flourish. There, now listen to this. Underline this in your Bible. There is a way that appears to be right, but in the end, it leads to death. Look at that again. There is a way that appears to be right. It looks good. It makes sense because that's the way that everybody's going. It must be right. And yet, it leads to destruction. Let's pray. Father, I thank you this morning for your goodness in our lives, and I pray for the next few minutes, Lord, that you would arrest our attention and help us to understand that just because the masses appear to be going one way, we're not to jump on the train and join them. Help us, Lord, to pursue righteousness over anything that is expedient, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So this week, I decided to get ambitious, and I decided that I needed to hashtag kill the dad bod. How many know what a dad bod is? It's where you have a little bit of this too much. So I decided that I was going to do some things to try and get in shape, and so I, like many times, I don't know why I do this, but I jump all in. And so I went from not running, Katie, because I know you've done a lot of different types of running programs. I went from not running to, I'm going to do like 20 sprints today. And that was 2.5 days ago. My hips, when I walk right now, hurt like the dickens. I mean, it's painful. And I want to be in better shape now than I was at this age than I was at the last age. 10 years ago, whatever that may be. But how many of you know that not all is what it seems in the area of fitness? And I mean that seriously. There's been discoveries over the years that they've come to find that they thought this was the way that you should work out, and then they came back and said, no, science, we studied, that's all wrong. Forget it, don't ever do that. Even if the internet tells you to. But what's worse, to me at least, is that there are actually things on the grocery store labeled healthy that are not.
Right.
Yeah, that's right.
Are you here this morning? Have you ever gone and gotten one of those delicious key lime yogurt things that has like the little flip over cup, the little goodness, and you mix it all together, you go, I'm eating healthy, it only has, you know, so many calories, and it's delicious. Then you read how much sugar is in that, and it's like this big. Look, that's the same amount of sugar as in a can of soda. And you go, I thought I was being healthy, it's yogurt, bro. And yet, you find out it's not to be. Don't even get me started on energy bars. You mean to tell me that there is a healthy s'mores energy bar? I need energy. I'm going to be running a few laps, apparently. And it tastes like cookies. And yet, come to find out, not healthy, not healthy. For years, people have been warning against diet soda, and it's just recently that it's hit the mainstream that, yes, it is very bad for you. And yet, it's diet. How can it be bad? My boys are here this morning, and they don't like this one. Give them a plain bowl of oatmeal, and they look at you like you have a third eye. But give them the maple brown sugar flavor. And it's like a bowl of, it's oatmeal, it's healthy, right? It's oatmeal. I mean, it says it on the package. No, not healthy. Full of sugar.
Yes.
How about those of you, you get your fruit from a little can, and it's called a fruit cocktail. And you go, praise the Lord, I had one of the five food groups, I had my fruit. And you know what they do? They cut up all the fruit, and then they take a bottle of corn syrup, and they just shove as much corn syrup on top of that fruit, and you feel good about it, right? Because you're like, I had fruit. I ate fruit today. That's like my grandma used to make Jell-O, and then she'd sneak fruit into it, just to desperately, in some way, shape, or form, get fruit in your body. And you know what she did? You'd eat around it, you know, and there'd be a bowl of oranges left. Here you go, grandma. They ate all the... You know, it's funny, but isn't that what Proverbs is saying? There's a way that seems right, but in the end it leads to death. Have you ever found yourself in a place where you thought you were doing something right, and it turns out you were oh so wrong? I'll never forget the first and only time I bought a new car. This was over 20 years ago. I was driving this old beater, Beretta. How many of you remember Chevy Berettas? This thing was awesome when it ran. I mean, it was amazing. If it ran, it was awesome. And I remember I was having so much struggle with this thing, and I was probably only 18 or 19 at the time. And I was driving it through an intersection, and it literally died in the middle of an intersection. And it was a very busy intersection in the suburbs of Chicago. And I thought, that's it. I'm done. And I drove straight to the dealership, and I said, I want a brand new Beretta. Give it to me. And they said, it can be all yours for $300 a month for the next 60 months. That's a lot of money when you are 19 working a part-time job. And I said, where do I sign? Remember I said it was the first and only time I ever bought a new car. You see, you can look back at your life and you can say, I thought this was the right choice. And it turns out I was oh so wrong. There is a way that seems right, but in the end, it leads to death. This is very probably morbid and sadistic, maybe that's the right word. Now when I see someone go by with a brand new truck and a brand new fifth wheel camper, I ask myself, their kids will be paying on that thing. As they'll be dead and gone before that thing's paid for. Solomon, again, was the wise illustrator. He gave us the illustration of the fool and the wise man. And he says, be careful. If you're taking notes this morning, write this down, because it's not just in Proverbs 14. This idea is all through Scripture, that there is a way that seems right, but in the end it leads to death. Proverbs chapter 16, verse 25 says this, there is a way that seems right to a man, but its end is the way of death. Proverbs chapter 12, verse 15, the way of a fool is right in his own eyes, but a wise man listens to advice. Boy, I could tell some stories, but I won't. You know, you just convince yourself, don't you, that it's right. And everybody else in the whole world must be wrong. And yet, Proverbs says, there's the fool says, this is right in my eyes. And he ignores advice. Jesus actually talked about this in Matthew chapter 7. He said this, enter by the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction. Boy, it was easy getting a 60-month loan. The way is easy that leads to destruction, and those who enter it are many. That's probably the most sad thing about what Jesus said. He said the way to destruction is easy, it's broad, and here's the thing. Most people choose it. That's what Jesus said. For the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are few. Have you noticed that sometimes life is hard? Jesus said, it's supposed to be. I don't know about you, but I prefer the easy. I mean, I really do, I'm not gonna lie. The easier, the better. But yet, I find no matter what I do, I run across these situations, these circumstances that are out of my control where I go, boy, that's hard. That's just plain hard. And you know what Proverbs screams to me? Welcome to the club. It's hard to stay with the same person for 20 years. Amen? You don't have to say amen. I know you can pretend that you're holy and love your spouse every day. But for some of us in the real world, it's hard. That's why a lot of people don't. I'm done. And we, I mean, the list for us is, it's just getting too long. I mean, we've lost count. Pastors, ministers, people that we know have respected and trusted and honored. It's too hard. See ya. Jesus said, and Solomon said, oh, that's easy. When we were in Florida a couple months ago, there's now these huge signs, billboards, that you can get a divorce in one day for $199. Come on in, bring your checkbook. We'll take care of it in one day. It's easy. Easy. You see, there's a reason that I'm preaching on this particular this text today, and that is because all that we hear in culture many times is the opinions of men. That, if you don't know this yet, are constantly changing to whatever is expedient. In other words, this is what's popular today. This is what we all believe today. We don't know about tomorrow or next week or next month or next year, but this is what we believe. And James says in the book of James that if you're tossed to and fro by the beliefs of men, guess what? You're going to be unstable in all. Everybody say all. All your ways. That's what James said. So we have to realign ourselves with the fact that we have to choose the difficult road. So if you're here this morning, you may be asking, how do we know which way is right? How do we know which way is wrong? And how can we choose the wise way as opposed to the foolish way? Well, I'm glad you asked. If you're taking notes, write this down this morning. Number one, we need to learn God's way.
Amen.
Now, some of you, that just went in one ear and out the other. That was a Sunday school sounding answer. But I'm here to tell you this morning, God's way affects every choice that you have to make. I said every.
That's right.
Every. Every choice. Now, God may not, like if you, God, should I stay with my wife? Should I not stay with my wife? God's going to look at you and be like, don't be an idiot. It's pretty clear, right? So there are some of those situations that hopefully God's not going to have to, there may be some exceptions to the rule, I understand that. But there are some things where it gets really complicated. And in the nitty-gritty small stuff where we're struggling, I'm here to tell you this morning, God is a way.
Yeah.
We have to learn it. A couple of months ago, several of us went through financial peace and we learned that we haven't been handling money God's way. Here's the thing, there's a lot of areas in our life where we need God's word to shine a light on how we should live. Yeah. Ladies, have you ever been in the car lost with your man?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Have you softly suggested stopping for directions?
Softly.
How did that go? Right? Guys would just assume, get run over before they get out and stop and ask for the directions. And yet, the reality is that's how we are sometimes. I'll confess. I'll be going through something and I'll go and I'll unload on somebody. I'll tell them all the junk I'm going through in my life. And I'll just let them have it. Here's what I'm thinking and here's what's happening. Kind of like a vomit fest almost when it's all said and done. And they end it by saying this. Have you prayed about it? Would you shut up? I'm trying to tell you something here. Don't get all spiritual on me. I'm going through some stuff. Right? And yet, it's true. Many times we're more comfortable unloading on someone, and there's a good reason why. We can see them, we can read their body language, we feel better when it's over. But I don't know if you know this or not, but they're not God.
Yeah.
And they're not going to tell you what you should do. You have to go to God. Amen?
Amen.
Yeah.
Someone once said, decisions become easier when your will to please God outweighs your will to please yourself. I'll say that again. Decisions become easier when your will to please God outweighs your will to please yourself. Well, I don't know about you, but I pray very selfishly many times. And yet, God's moving me, and He wants to move me to a place where I want to please Him. Not myself, not the person next to me, maybe, that I'm praying for. You see, because if we're focused on pleasing God, He'll take care of the rest. So many people in life, they get frustrated, they get confused by the circumstances of life. They're overwhelmed, and you know what? Pleasing God is the furthest thing from their mind. They're just focused on fixing. God, fix this for me. Change this. Do this. This person over here, he's an idiot. Would you just, you know, whatever. That's not focused on pleasing God. That's focused on, I want not real bad things, but bad things to happen to this person. And you see, God wants to examine our motives. That's one of the things God's been teaching me lately is God is always examining the why. Why do you want that? Why are you praying that? Why do you have that expectation? And you know what? That's kind of not fun. Because when God starts asking you about your motives, you can find some ugly stuff, unfortunately. And yet, that's also the quickest way back to God's way. Is to say, God, it's not about me. That's why last week we read in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 6, in all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will make your path straight. Boy, it's hard when you're parenting, isn't it? You know exactly what your child should do, why they should do it, and what the outcome will be. Right? Amen. I know. And yet, we don't see what's happening behind the scenes, what God's doing. But God is doing something. God may be leading them down a different path than we went down.
Amen.
Because He has to teach them something deeper than He had to teach us. Are you here this morning?
Amen.
Your child's path may not look like your path. But it's because God has to teach him something different than He taught you. Amen. That's some good preaching right there. I don't care if you agree or not. Number two, if you're taking notes, we have to learn from the past. There's no question that experience is a brutal teacher. You don't want to know why? Because I had to pay that $300 for the next 60 months, no matter how bad a job I had. And I had some bad, not good paying jobs back then. But guess what? You learn.
Yes.
C.S. Lewis said this, experience is the most brutal of teachers, but by God, you learn. You learn. I start to pray a little bit more this way. God, don't let me do anything stupid today. That's actually a pretty smart prayer. Keep me from my own stupidity. God, please. I know. You know, it's like, you know, if you're ever bored and you want to YouTube anything, that should have just got a laugh right there. Left. And you want to get lost on YouTube for a couple hours, go to YouTube and Google homemade mousetraps. Boy, you'll have fun for hours and hours and hours. But there's these guys that live on farms, and so they're overrun with mice, and they've come up with a way that it's called walk the plank. Sarah, you've seen it? They put a bucket of water, they build a plank that has a diving board that collapses with peanut butter on the end. And so you watch these mice, and you go, They can't be that stupid, really. You know what I mean? And the videos are awesome. I know all of you, whatever you had planned today, this is what you're going to do now. They go, and some of them, they actually survive the first drop. And you would think, that would be enough. Okay, I'm leaving. I'm done. This is not right. Something here is transpiring in my brain. But no, they go back. And some of these guys catch 9, 10, 15 mice in one night. It's awesome. You gotta watch it, Jody. Sometimes we need to see ourselves as correctly, and we have to say, look, but for the grace of God, there go I.
Yeah.
God, protect me. Keep me from my own ignorance. Here's the thing. If you're human, you're going to make mistakes.
Yep.
But the key is, don't do that again.
Yeah.
Right? Remember when you're kids? Don't touch the oven, don't touch the oven, don't touch the stove, don't touch the oven, it's hot. Boom! Ah! That was bad, but I'm assuming you won't do that again. Pain has a purpose. Did you know that?
Yes.
Yep.
That's right.
God gave us pain to say, ouch, that hurts. Don't do that again. Right? I can do kind of a front flip, kind of, on our trampoline. Kind of. So my boys are all like, you're going to do a backflip now? Nope.
Mm-mm.
Nope. I have no desire. Why? I've tried one before, probably, and it hurt, therefore pain, therefore no. Learn from your past. Proverbs chapter 26, 11 says, a dog returns to its own vomit, like a fool repeating his foolishness. It's bad when you make dumb mistakes, but it's really bad when you keep doing it over and over. Don't be that guy. That's what Solomon said. Don't keep repeating the same mistakes. God, that hurts, you know? Our white car is the old glory, but it has issues again this week, so it's sitting up there. And as excited and as enthusiastic as some of my boys are, they're like, I guess we just need to go buy a new car. I go, nope, I've done that before, it's not good, and I'm not going to do it again. But that's easy. Learn from your mistakes. Finally, number three, I'm wrapping up. Learn from others. Now, you can go to YouTube and do this too, if you want. Old guys, backflip, trampoline, that's up to you. But here's the thing. I am amazed at how many people come to the place in life where they are no longer teachable. And the reason that they become come that way is they go, look, I've been through a lot, I've experienced a lot, I've had a lot of pain, I've had a lot of problems, I've changed my life, I've gotten myself to this particular situation through a lot of stupid choices, and you know what, they're genuinely good people. But here's the thing, if you're not careful, you come to a place, I don't care if you're 7 or 700, you have something that God still wants to teach you.
Yeah.
If you're still above ground and not below ground, you should be teachable. Yeah. Period.
Yes.
But how many people come to that place and go, nah, I got it all figured out. I just got it all figured out. They're no longer teachable. And yet, the kingdom of God is set up in such a way that we learn from each other. Proverbs chapter 27, verse 9 says this, oil and perfume make the heart glad, and the sweetness of a friend comes from his earnest counsel. You see, we should always have someone in our life who can glean and teach us something. The older I get, the more I see how resistant I am to that. But lately, what I've been realizing is, what if I just took the posture that I had a whole heck of a lot to learn from anybody?
Yeah.
And I've been doing that and exercising in that and asking other pastors questions. What do you do about this? I just had an incredible conversation with a pastor recently. And I don't want to talk too much about this because my kids are here, but about raising teenagers. And this pastor's gone through the ringer. And I can't begin to tell you, his words to me about it were like oil and perfume. It was so encouraging and so uplifting. He knew exactly what I was talking about, exactly what I was going through. And he, since, subsequently, has asked me follow-up questions. It's awesome to be teachable. Be committed to being a lifelong learner. Period. Don't stop reading. Don't stop learning. Don't stop watching YouTube videos. That's the lesson of today. No. Now we're going to close. Here's what I want you to take away from this today as we close. Understand this. There's two ways. The easy way and the hard way. Don't go running down the easy way with everybody else. Amen? Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you that it is life-giving to us, that it speaks to our hearts. It brings correction. It brings direction. And it brings protection. I pray that we would be a people, Lord, that are rooted in your word. Make us wise as serpents and innocent as doves, as you said. That's the type of people that we want to be, wise as serpents, but innocent as doves. I pray for those who are here this morning, those watching online, God, that you would just confirm this message in their hearts today.